Greetings. Let's do the right thing, the best thing, and go to our knees in prayer. How does that sound? The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Oh, good Lord, we thank you, Jesus, for being so loving and patient with us and for your great mercy. We thank you for the blessing of this parish family of Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish. We thank you for the opportunity this evening for our children and our adults to come and to be open to your great love, to be open to your holy wisdom. We pray, Lord, that you be with us all here and bless this place and be present among us, among all of us here this evening, again, adults and children. And we pray that you bless all those who teach and bless all your people, that our hearts and minds might be open. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you guide and lead us. For we do not know how to pray as we ought, and that you empower us and anoint us with power from on high and speak through us and open our hearts and minds. And we pray, Blessed Mother, we pray as we are under your title, under your name of the Immaculate Heart, we pray, Blessed Mother, that you indeed pray for us, that you intercede on our behalf and that you always lead us to your Son and that you help us and pray for us that we might be faithful disciples of your Son, that we might be real disciples, authentic disciples, that we might be open to the call to holiness, to conversion, that we might respond to this call to be the saints, to be one of the saints. And we pray also on this day of the feast day of St. Margaret Mary, we pray, Margaret Mary, for your intercession and prayers as well. And so, Lord, again, bless us and give us your grace. Be with us this evening. We pray these things in your holy name. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay. So we will get right at it. Again, the first few sessions, we were kind of just setting the stage for what's to come. At the beginning, we were kind of getting things situated, set up, and now we're going to really get into the heart of the matter, into really what's most important, and that's what we're going to be delving into tonight. But first, I want to go back to a question that we had last night, which was generated from back at that part of the church, and so the question was: I had spoke about when we are really grounded in Christ, when we have this relationship with the Lord, and the Holy Spirit dwells within us, that our life is filled with a sense of peace and joy that we otherwise wouldn't have. That others in the world who don't know the Lord, don't have that intimate relationship with the Lord, a lot of times they're filled with great anxiety and worry and doubt because they don't have that faith, that anchor, that gift of faith and grace that we find in that relationship with the Lord. And so someone asked the question, and it's a good question, and that's why I bring it up, because I wasn't able to adequately respond to it before the end of our session, and you had to many of you go and pick up your children as those classrooms were ending. And so the question was, so then if one is an authentic disciple, will they experience anxiety or doubts or any of those types of emotions or feelings or situations? And the answer is yes. The answer is yes. So what I said about that joy and that peace that we get in the Lord is true for the most part, but there's some factors that can cause us to indeed, even though in spite of being an authentic disciple of the Lord, that we can still have difficult times, that we can still have doubts, we can still have anxiety and worry and all of those things. And so I had mentioned that some of this is a little advanced in terms of spiritual teaching. You know, it'd be more like a, I don't know what I said last time, course number 360 or something, and not 110. But I do want to go back and touch on that a little bit. So, first of all, we'll even be an authentic disciple. Sometimes we'll still have that anxiety and doubts and all of those things. Why? Because of us. Because we're sinners. We don't have perfect faith. We don't have that perfect love for the Lord. It's tainted. Right? Because we're humans. We're sinners. We're fallible. Right? So there will be times, yes, because, not because of a failing of the Lord, but because of really our failing. It could be our failing because of our lack of faith or of trust or of belief or because of our sin. Okay, so that's one explanation. Another reason why we might experience those types of things is because it can come from Satan, from the enemy. And a little further on these evenings, we will talk about the spiritual battle. We will talk about Satan, because Satan is real. And it's very important that for our spiritual growth and spiritual life, that we talk about it and that we deal with it in a real responsible way and not be caught off guard. So yeah, that can come from Satan. Satan can indeed attack us in many ways. And so that can, again, be an explanation, a reason why we might go through a difficult situation of anxiety or doubt. You know, there's always that spiritual attack. So that's possible. Another reason is sometimes it can come actually from the Lord. Not that the Lord inflicts something bad upon us, but he sometimes will allow something to happen to us. So sometimes he'll allow something to happen to us. And so what I started to explain last time, which again we ran out of time, is that sometimes God will call us, invite us, allow us to become a suffering servant for the Lord. That we'll be allowed to participate really in the passion of the Lord. And you know, I used an example with you of St. Francis of Assisi. So if you think about St. Francis of Assisi, St. Francis received the wounds of Christ. The very wounds of Christ. And many other saints were allowed to enter into being a suffering soul for Christ. And so there's a lot, certainly a lot more that could be said, and perhaps later in the future we can get to that. The whole theology of suffering, why do bad things happen to good people, these types of things are all important and worthy of our discussion, but I'm going to put them off for later because it'll be better situated after we have some more foundational stuff that we can go through. But I just wanted to respond again to that question before we move forward. And we will touch on some of that again, hopefully in the future. So tonight, again, we jump right in to prayer. So really, at the crux of all of this, in terms of our relationship with God, is prayer. Prayer. There is no saint. There is no intimate relationship with Christ. There is no growing in holiness. There is no authentic disciple without a real prayer life. A deep prayer life. A deep prayer life. In fact, I'd like to give an example. If you recall, earlier in one of the sessions, I spoke about St. Ignatius of Loyola. If you remember, I spoke about St. Ignatius of Loyola, and I told you about his life and how he grew up, and then he was injured in battle, and he was bedridden because of his injuries, and here he is, stuck in bed, and where he was, all they had was a Bible and a book of the saints. How boring. And he was bored to tears, and it wasn't until he finally reached the tipping point. He's like, okay, I'm so bored, I'm even going to read this Lives of the Saints. And he did. And so he read the Lives of the Saints, and he was so moved in reading that book about the saints, because his whole life was about being heroic, being a hero in battle, as a soldier, in battle. And he said, wow, these are the real heroes. This is the real battle. And he wanted to then change his life and become one of the saints. And, of course, we know he made it. But it didn't happen overnight. Of course, it never does. So I want to share with you another saint. Because we just celebrated this saint's feast day just earlier this week. That's St. Teresa of Avila. So St. Teresa of Avila, we just celebrated her feast day Tuesday, I believe it was. So, St. Teresa of Avila, what I want to share with you is that she came from a well-to-do family in Spain, and she, in the day, it was pretty popular for wealthy people to have their son or daughter enter a monastery or a convent, especially when they were young. In some ways, it was almost like a boarding school. And so it wasn't so much about authentic conversion that I want to serve my life as a nun or a brother or a priest in terms of laying down my life and living like Christ in the gospel, laying down my life for others. The motivations were less than noble, less than holy. But so St. Teresa finds herself in the convent at a fairly young age. And her convent was a mess. the sisters there just really weren't living what would you would expect as a holy life, as a life dedicated to God. And but it didn't bother her so much until later in her life, when roughly she was about 38 years old. She had an experience that really could be nothing less than an encounter with God. And in this experience, she felt a radical call to change her life, to conversion, as I've preached about last time, conversion, and a call to holiness and to change your life. And in that, the Lord helped her to see that what was necessary was prayer. Prayer. And so she embraced prayer with all her being. And that became the key to her holiness. And not just her holiness, but others. Because she brought about a tremendous change in Europe. All because, really, because she embraced prayer. In her embrace of prayer, she had this conversion, this growth in holiness, what we would call a saint. And in that, she began to make changes in her convent. Well, that didn't go over well with her fellow sisters, right? Because, you know, the saying, the truth hurts. So, you know, people don't like being told that they're sinning or doing something wrong and they need to change. And so she suffered a lot of difficulty. She was persecuted and went through a lot. But her and St. John of the Cross, he was doing something similar in his monastery with the guys as well. So at the same time, they were reforming the Carmelite order and brought about the Reformed Carmelites, which was a group of men and women that wanted to live a more authentic calling to be like Christ, a more authentic calling to holiness. And so again, through that prayer brought about a big change for many people's lives in Europe. So I want to go to Luke chapter 6, verse 12. In those days, Jesus departed to the mountain to pray. Jesus departed to the mountain to pray. We often see that. And I think it should really say a lot to us. It should mean a lot to us that if Jesus himself, who's the Son of God, the Messiah, is divine, if he spent time in prayer with the Father, if he needed it and sought that out, shouldn't we all the more? Shouldn't we all the more seek out that mountain to pray? So not only do we see Jesus in the gospel frequently going to prayer, but especially in light of important moments of his life, of his ministry. And again, that should say something to us, especially in critical moments of our life, all the more reason to be on our knees and in prayer. But often, sadly, what happens, what I have seen as a priest and pastor, is oftentimes when people are in a difficult time and in the greatest need of prayer and of God, they turn away from God. Sad. Very sad. In those days, Jesus departed to the mountain to pray. He spent the night in prayer to God. He spent the night in prayer. Ah, that's a beautiful thing to see. You know, imagine the Lord getting away from the noise and distractions, and he just wanted to be in union with God the Father, just in prayer, in union. And then when the morning came, he chooses the 12 apostles. So it's in some way connected to that, that choosing of the 12. That in this union with the Father, almost like, Father, who are the 12 I should pick, perhaps? You know, help me pick the right 12 to be my apostles, to be the beginning of the church, the nucleus of the church. And then, if you go to the Gospel of St. John, chapter 17. Now, so we see a number of places where it says Jesus went to go pray, and he spent the night in prayer, and after the prayer he did such and such. But usually we don't hear what he's saying. So wouldn't it be cool to like listen in? You know, what does he say to the Father? What does his prayer sound like? Well, if you remember, the apostles did ask him at one point. They said, Lord, John the Baptist taught his disciples, can you teach us? And remember, that's when he gave them the Our Father, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven. So it was a recipe for prayer. So if you look at that, Our Father, so who you're addressing. Just like when we talk to someone, like, hey, so-and-so, you know, you're addressing a particular person. So Our Father, we're addressing him. But not only that you're addressing, but it's even in the way, because it's like Father or Daddy. It's like Daddy. So instead of our God who art there somewhere distant and removed, but it's Daddy. So it's about a relationship, about being close to this person, to this God, the one true God, to being close to God. So again, Daddy, who is in heaven, holy is your name. You know, so it's praising God. Praise you, God. You are holy. Right? You are holy. And then praying that, God, I pray that your will be done, that as you have things in heaven, that they be done here, that things go according to your plan, that we live in accord with your plan, and we're open to your will, and we live and carry out your will on this earth. Right? And then, give us today what we need. Give us our daily bread. Give us our needs. You know, we can think of our needs in terms of actual bread, like we all need to eat to survive. But give us the Eucharist. So, you know, some of the early saints spoke of it in terms of a foreshadowing of give us the bread from heaven, the Eucharist. And then forgive us our sins. Forgive us, God, our sins. But then comes really a hard part. Because if we pray it, boy, we better know what we're saying, right? As we forgive others. Oh, no. So wait a minute. What did I just say? I take it back, God. Sorry. All those Our Fathers I said, I better take that back. Because I don't know if I can forgive everyone else the way I want you to forgive me. I want you to forgive me unconditionally and totally. But can I forgive others that have wronged me? Okay, so he gives us a pattern of prayer. But apart from that short little prayer, where else can we turn? Well, John chapter 17. The whole chapter is one long, big prayer. It's wonderful. The whole chapter, one big prayer as Jesus is talking to the Father. And we have it recorded here. Wow, it's almost one of the apostles had a tape recorder rolling right there and was listening in on his prayer. So Jesus is speaking with him, and then he raises his eyes to heaven. He says, Father, Father. See, so how he addresses God, he lets us address God the same way. Father, the hour has come. Give glory to your Son, that your Son may glorify you. Now this is eternal life, that they should know you, Father, that they should know you and the one you sent, me, Jesus Christ. I revealed your name to those that you gave me. They belong to you and you gave them to me. Now they know everything is from you. Because Jesus made it clear that what Jesus did and said wasn't, he brought what the Father told him to bring. What he said and did is what the Father asked him to do. Because the words you gave to me, I've given to them. And it goes on. So I encourage you to look at that. John chapter 17. So it's wonderful to see how he talks to the Father. And he asks for things. He's asking here for help for the apostles. Those that have heard him preach and have heard the word of truth. But then he goes on, I pray not only for them, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. That's us. Those who believe in me through their word. I pray for them. That's us. So he's praying to the Father for us. He knew each of us, and he's praying to the Father for us. Then he goes on to this one part that is in many ways sad, I think. He prays that they might all be one, as you, Father, and I are one. That they might be one as we are one. So then the question is, are we one? how do you see it as one? How can we see it as one when we're so divided in our families and in our homes and at our workplace and in our parishes, and we're so divided in our churches, you know, all the different Christian churches. Just before Mass, I was talking with someone, just after Mass, the 5:30 Mass, and before this, I was talking with someone, and this person had the same experience I've had, that sometimes when you go into some of the Protestant churches, you'll hear preaching against Catholics, that we're bad and we're going to go to hell and the Pope's the Antichrist. I think, how sad that they have nothing better to do to talk bad about us. I'm pretty sure I've never, in all my life as a priest and all the homilies I get, ever preached horrible things about my Protestant brothers and sisters in Christ. So again, not that we don't sin against our brothers and sisters in Christ, but that's the point, is how are we one when we're doing that, when we're divided and sinning? How are we one? So the Lord's Prayer is still there. So sometimes I pray, Lord, I pray this prayer. These words of Scripture I make my own and unite them to yours. Father, I repeat the words of your Son Jesus. Please help us be one. So let's go now to the Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7. Jesus says, ask, it'll be given to you. Seek, you'll find. Knock, the door will be opened. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. The one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you would hand a stone to your son when he asks for a loaf of bread? Or give him a snake if they ask for a fish? If you who are wicked and sinners know how to give good things to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good things to those who ask? So we are called to ask. So in our prayers, as you heard in the Our Father, to have petitions that we ask for things. We ask for good things for ourselves and for others. The Father hears our prayers and he helps us in our needs. And while we're still on the Gospel of Matthew, let's go to chapter 18. And verse 19. Again, amen, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything for which they are prayer, it shall be granted to them by my heavenly Father. For where two or three are gathered together, I am there. So even in prayer, when we're gathered in prayer, that the Lord is with us. He promised that the Lord Jesus is with us. Now, of course, he's truly with us, body, blood, soul, and divinity in the Holy Eucharist, but he's with us in prayer. And then, if we can go to Luke, there's a lot of verses, of course, we could look at in terms of prayer. I'm just highlighting just a few for you for your reflection. Again, to illustrate the point that prayer is important and Jesus talks about it. It's in the Bible and it's important and it's not an option. It's what we need to do. And in fact, it shouldn't be an obligation or a chore. It should be something we look forward to, something we should long for. Because in that prayer, we have intimacy with God and that's what it's all about. So Luke 11, 5. And Jesus said to them, suppose one of you has a friend to me goes at midnight and says, friend, give me three loaves. For a friend of mine has arrived at my house from a journey. I have nothing to offer. But the guy in the house says, remember, don't bother me. The door's locked. We're already in bed. I can't get up to give you anything. And Jesus says, I tell you, if he does not get up because of their friendship, he will get up because that person keeps bugging him at the door. Why is he saying this? He's saying, bug me. So we're supposed to be like that guy that comes in the middle of the night and keeps knocking, give me bread. So that's what we're supposed to do, is persistence in prayer. Keep bugging God. He wants us to bug him, bother him. He likes it. Most of us don't like to be bothered and bugged, right? But he does. He wants it. Bug him. Okay. So, we're supposed to pray. We see Jesus. We read about it in the Bible. Prayer is important. Well, what is prayer? So just a few things. Again, there's a lot that could be said, but I just chose a few things. From St. Thérèse of Lisieux, who we just celebrated her feast day recently too. St. Thérèse of Lisieux. This is what she had to say. A very beautiful, holy young lady that died at the age of 24. 24. Beautiful saint. She said, prayer is a surge of the heart, and it is a simple look turned toward heaven. It's a surge of the heart turned toward heaven. And St. John Damascene, one of the early church fathers, said, prayer is the raising of one's mind and heart to God. St. Ignatius of Loyola, who I've spoken about now twice, he said this, we must speak to God as a friend speaks to a friend. We must speak to God as a friend speaks to a friend. now asking for a favor, and then acknowledging our faults and communicating all that concerns us, our thoughts, our fears. So, what does prayer do to us? Well, I spoke about that, I forget, one of the last times, right? I don't know, one or two times ago. Things all blur after a while for me, I'm sorry. But, what does prayer do to us? Remember, I spoke about that peace and that joy, about just feeling an effusion of God's love. Because it's in that prayer that we form this union with God, that we get to know God, and that we enter into this relationship. And it's in prayer that we are energized to go about our day. You know, when we're running on empty and we're just so busy with work and with our children and with all of our obligations and with school and so many things, and we get run down and we just need to be refilled. We need to be re-energized. That's when we go to prayer. The Lord fills us back up. He gives us what we need. That blessing, that grace, His love, the comfort, the peace, so that we're ready to go again. So what I have often done as a priest over, you know, all the years that I've been a priest is, you know, if I'm having a tough day or there have been some difficult situations, you know, I just went to the hospital and someone's dying and, you know, maybe they were in a car accident and the family's there and it's very sad and tragic someone has committed suicide, and someone's little child has leukemia, and you know all the you know someone's spouse just left them, and all these crises that I deal with all the time, all these difficult, hard things that happen in life, because life is filled with lots of crises. You know, look at the news, read the paper. Well, sometimes just look at our own lives, and so as I'm trying to minister all these situations. I find that I just find my way to the church, and I come in, and since I've been here, I often, I don't know, kneel right there, that first pew. That's my spot. You can share it with me anytime you want, but I use that spot. At my last church, I don't know why, it was about right about there, you're in my spot. From my other church. It was right about there. I don't know why. It just that became my spot. And I'd come in. I'd just go to my knees. And I'd look at the cross. You know, and there's so many things that you can pray and meditate just on the crucifixion. So many things. It says so much to me. But I just found consolation as I'd kneel and before the Lord. I just would feel the Lord taking away the burden and the weight and the difficulty and the sadness and just bringing me peace and comfort and joy. And it didn't take long. I could be there 5 minutes or maybe a half hour. And then I was good. And I could go back to my office and face whatever else came my way. I was ready. And so we'll speak more about that. But just that's what prayer does for us. That's what happens to us in prayer. So, now, this next piece is really important. So these are all just little pointers that I put down that have to do with prayer and, again, our spiritual life. So in some ways, remember, this is like spiritual direction, like the director and the directees. So it's almost like spiritual direction. It's like, you know, some pointers from my life, from the Word of God, and from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, and from the saints, from those who have done it and perfected it. And so this one is very important, and I want to impress this upon you. Make every action and word count. I'll say it again. Make every word and action count. Don't just go through the motions. It's better than nothing. Okay, I'll give you, well, I don't. I'm sure God will give you a little bonus star for that. But you get so many more bonus stars if you do it better. None of the half stuff, halfway stuff, right? None of the halfway stuff. None of the just going through the motions and just blah, 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 blah. Remember, Jesus spoke about in the Bible, remember? He said, don't think that you can win God's ear by the sheer multiplication of your words. Like just by, if I say a lot of words or talk a lot, that's going to mean I'm really holy or growing in holiness. It could be one word could outdo the 300 of this other person. Just that one word. Depending on how it was said, how it was done. Does that make sense? So, for instance, I'm going to give you a for instance. So, you show up on Sunday, and you come up those stairs, and you come, you're heading towards the big doors, and the baptismal font is right there, right? And, you know, everybody else is just going like this, you know. You know, and getting a quick splash bath or, you know, and not even thinking what they're doing, right? It's just something we do. I don't know, just something we're doing. And maybe even if someone asked you, like, if you had a little kid, Mommy, why are you doing that? I don't know, just do it. We all do it. It's just something we do. I don't know why. Looks cool. I don't know. We all do it. So do we know why we're doing it? Or do we even think about it? Or do we just do it? That's something we do. I don't know. I didn't even think about it. I just did it and walked in. Didn't even think about it, right? But imagine instead. This is just one example. I give you a million, but this is just one example. Imagine you approach that and you think, this is holy blessed water. This water is used for baptisms. What is baptism? Well, baptism is when either a child or adult is made a member of the household of God, brought into the very family of God. In baptism, one is cleansed of their sins. In baptism, one receives grace beyond grace and blessing beyond blessing. In baptism, we receive the beginning of the fullness of the Spirit that isn't completed until confirmation, but we receive the Holy Spirit. All these things and more in baptism. So I'm approaching this baptismal font thinking, wow, this is some powerful stuff here. And I am going to touch it and make the sign of the cross, one, because it's calling to mind my baptism. I'm basically renewing my baptism. Remember, in baptism, as an adult, or if you bring your child, the parent says that I will raise this child to know and keep the teachings of the church. And I renounce sin and Satan and profess to live the gospel. Right? It's a rejection of sin and a professing of your faith in Christ the Lord. So that's what you're doing. I'm renewing my baptism. I reject Satan and profess my faith in Christ Jesus. Right? I'm renewing my baptism. And I do it in the sign of the cross, the sign by which we are saved. That's why we sign ourselves. It's calling to mind. Because actually, when we go to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen, that's a prayer. Even that little thing is a prayer. And we're signing ourselves that I am saved by this sign. He redeemed me and has given me the gift of eternal life in that sign. So all of those things are going on while you're doing the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay? Right? That's just one thing. Right? Okay. We haven't even got inside the church yet. We're still in the narthex. So then we come in the big doors or whatever doors. We come in, okay? So we come in and we're walking up and we come to our pew. And then what do? As Catholic Christians, we genuflect. So watch how we do it. This is how we go. It's just this little, and that was it. Right? And the Lord's like, what the heck was that? That's a genuflect? That's lame. So again, we do a genuflect down, you know? So what is that? When we genuflect, it, you know, the same thing, you know, whether we're in medieval Europe and we're kneeling before the king or the queen, we're showing honor to that person, that we're the subject and they're our master, right? We're showing honor and to this person. Well, in this case, it's not some king or queen. Well, it is the king of kings. But it's not just some anybody king or queen. It's the king of kings, right? So we're genuflecting before God, before the Lord. We're showing honor and that we recognize that I'm nothing. I'm the creature. You're the creator, right? That's what that's about, right? And showing reverence for the Eucharist, for Christ Jesus reserved in the tabernacle. So showing honor to God, recognizing Christ himself. So that's just, again, just see these little things and think about everything else in your life when it comes to prayer and your relationship with God, and do them with meaning. Do them like it counts, like it's important, right? In your prayers too. So if you're going to pray the rosary, now again, just speeding through it in 10 minutes is fine and good. Okay, you still get some grace. But imagine if you actually did it and went slowly and thought about every word and did it meaningful and prayerful. Can you imagine what a great gift that is to God? Or instead of, you know, you pray the Our Father, maybe that's something you do in the morning or at night, and it's Our Father who art, and you speed through it, and it's like, what? Instead, what if you did just the Our Father to take the place of 10 Hail Marys? Seriously, get rid of the 10 Hail Marys and do one really super good Our Father that takes you maybe a half hour. Wow. Huh? Each word, just pausing and thinking if each word has meaning and importance in that prayer that Jesus gave. It better be, it's a pretty important prayer. He gave it to us. It's got to be important, right? And to make it really that it counts. And I mean it. Each word, I mean it. And if I didn't mean it, I'm going back and I'm doing it again because I'm going to do it right. I want it to mean something. I don't want to just babble on some words, right? So again, like I said, I'll read it because I have it typed here. Make every action and word count with meaning. Everything. Does that make sense? That's so important. Just that right there will get you way down the path of holiness. Seriously, that'll make a huge difference. The little things. God loves the little things. Seriously. The little things. Shoot, the little things, St. Therese of Lisieux, the little way. That was her whole thing. It doesn't have to be some big thing. The little things done with great love. Mother Teresa of Calcutta said the same thing. God doesn't call us to great things. God doesn't call us to be great heroes or world-class people on this planet and make a big splash. He calls us to do little things with great love. What does that mean, little things with great love? That means when you change your daughter's diaper, that you do it with great love. And when you mop the floor at your job as a janitor, you do it with great love. Or whatever you're doing in life, that you do it with great love. The little things done with love. Right? There are so many saints that said that very thing. Many saints. Okay, how are we looking? Wow, time's moving, huh? Take a breath. Let's catch our breath. So, I'm going to follow up with what I just said with saying that even again, so we're a janitor and we clean the floors, that can be done for the greater honor and glory of God. Or we're a surgeon, we're doing heart surgery on someone at the hospital. That can be done for the greater glory of God. That you consecrate everything you do in your whole day, even the menial, so-called menial things that don't matter, do those dedicated to God. Lord, today, my scrubbing my toilets, I dedicate to you. You know? That we have God part of all that we do. Do you mean invite the Lord to be part of your day? I talk to Jesus. I hope people aren't watching because they're like, who's he talking to? Because sometimes I do it out loud, honestly. I try not to do it when people are around because they will think I'm cuckoo more than they already do. But I do. I'll talk to Jesus. I'm like, Lord, what do you think I should do about this? It's a prayer. And I, you know, I'm talking. And sometimes I'll tell him to come with me. I'll say, Lord, I got to drive over here. Would you go with me? And so have a seat. Lord, come with me. I mean, you don't need to. Of course, you're God. You could just meet me there. But come with me. I'd like you with me in the car. It would be safer that way. And then, you know, I got to tell you, just moving back to Denver, I was gone for 11 years. You know that. I was in Windsor. Moving back to Denver, it might help me grow in holiness or the opposite direction. I'm not sure. I'm referring to the traffic. Oh, Lord, please. For me, that's a good test of my Christianity. Lord, I sure want to cuss this person out, but I'm not going to. That would be a sin. Instead, I'm going to say, Lord, bless this person, please. And forgive me for any bad thoughts that I had, for any anger that welled up inside me really quick. A good test of our Christianity, driving in Denver, Colorado. Yes. Honest. I mean it. Okay, I'm going to leave with one last thing and then we'll go to questions if you have any. I want to say something about our lives and how distracting and noisy they are and how this works against what this is all about. Let me show you. And for this, young people are greater offenders than adults, but adults are offenders too. So, we climb in our car, immediately the radio's on. Immediately. In fact, it's always on, so you didn't even turn it off. It's still on from the last time. The radio is always on when we're in the car. As soon as we get in the house, it's the radio or the TV immediately is on. Huh? Or on the computer, or a video game, or whatever it is, our day, because we already have busy and noisy things anyhow, right? But we clutter it up, even the quiet moments. We can't, it's almost like we're uncomfortable in silence. We're uncomfortable in quiet. So what do? We fill it with noise and distraction. That's the exact opposite of what's needed, and it goes against all of what we're talking about here. Yep. How can you pray? How can you listen to the Holy Spirit speak to you in the depths of your being? You can't. That's no wonder. One consequence, I believe, is religious vocations are way down. Young men and women no longer hear calls to vocation because they don't hear God, period. All they hear is the radio and the video games and the TV. That's what they hear. When do they have quiet time to sit in God's presence? That's why I want to put a plug in for the Adoration Chapel. The Adoration Chapel, wow. There's so much grace involved in going there. So many powerful things can happen to you and others by your presence. Being in God's presence. Just to be in God's presence. Quiet. Still your mind. See, for some of you, this is going to be hard because you're not used to it. To just sit quiet for 5 minutes or a half hour or an hour, right? Some of you sit, you know, that are, you know, of course, we've had adoration here for a long time, but, you know, imagine some of you that are new to it or just started, you're like, wow, this is harder than it looks. This is tough to sit here 1 hour to make a 1 hour commitment to the Lord in adoration. That's hard to sit there. I get bored. I got to break out my iPhone and check my, I got to text someone. I don't know. I just thought of something. I got to text them or I got to email. I got to do something, right? We fill up our day with so much of that. So much of that. So now, I get in the car with someone, and they got the radio on, and it kind of bothers me, because I don't even listen to the radio anymore in the car. I mean, I'd say, out of, let's say, if I spent 10 hours in the car, there might be a half hour out of that 10 hours that I might have a little bit of music. It's not like I'm anti-music. I love music. But it's just, I find being in the car is some downtime. For me, it's downtime. It's quiet time. It's time to pray. I can grab my rosary. And what I like to do is I like to pray the Chaplet of Divine Mercy. That's one of my all-time favorites. I'll talk about that later because I think it's one of the most powerful prayers in the world. And so I'll speak more about that. But I'll grab it and I'll pray the Chaplet of Divine Mercy. Or I'll just talk to God while I'm driving. I'll just pray. I'll just talk to the Lord. Or I'll just sit and kind of veg. You know, when I was in Windsor, I was on a bunch of different committees for the Archbishop, so I had to drive to Denver all the time. So I did that, drive on I-25 more times than I can count. And, you know, a lot of times I'd be praying, but sometimes I'd just go into veg land, you know. And all of a sudden, there I was at the Archdiocese. Like, wow, I hope I didn't get in a wreck or hurt someone. I don't even remember. It's like, all of a sudden, I went in a transporter beam. I just kind of vegged, and all of a sudden, I was there. But, you know, I don't know what happened. But it's just a time for quiet and peace, just a downtime. Or, again, to use it for prayer, a beautiful time to pray in the car. At home, to, you know, okay, let's give the TV a break, and let's give the radio a break, and let's just have some quiet time at home. You know, maybe while we're having a meal or just sitting there and maybe have some time to do some spiritual reading on prayer in the morning or at night or whatever. But again, just to silence those things and let's just have some quiet. Get rid of the distractions for a little bit. Because seriously, how can you pray? How can the Holy Spirit speak to you and give you insight when there's all this competing voices for your attention? Does that make sense? Okay, I'm going to mark where I'm at. We're right here. So, any questions for tonight? We got 5 minutes before we wrap up. Questions, comments? Yes.
Question. You pray that you want to do God's will. And how do you know that you're doing God's will and not your own?
Okay. So the question is, you pray to do God's will, and how do you know if you're doing your will or God's will? That's a great question. So let me look at my sheet. I am looking at my sheet for a different reason. That's coming up to next Wednesday. See? It's right there. Honest. I am going to talk about that. It's right here, honest. Gee whiz. I'm going to talk about that next time. That's very important. So yeah, ultimately we want to do God's will. And so we pray to know God's will and to do God's will. And it would take me longer than a few minutes to answer, to be honest with you. Because there's more to it. It's not just a quick, simple thing. Because if it was, we'd all know it and we'd all be doing it. There's a lot to it. And so I want to flesh all that out, and that's coming up. It's down one, two, a few, six things down. So probably next time I'll get to it. But good question. So we will get to that, I promise. Anything else? Comments, concerns, questions, issues? What? Sure. Yeah. So part of that discernment is differentiating between the voice of God and the voice of Satan. So part of that Again, that's why this is a complex thing, and it's going to take us a while to unpack that. Because when you're discerning your life and what you're doing in God's will and all of those things, again, remember, Satan's always in the mix. So there's that the spiritual battle, and Satan's out to get us. It's that simple. And so we don't want to fall into his tricks and his plan. So that's an important piece of discernment. And we will get into that in depth because that's very important. So thank you, and we are going to get to that. I just made a note, so I'll remember, but we will get to that. Okay, so we'll just close in a quick prayer, okay? The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time together tonight. We thank you for being so good and loving to us, and for your invitation to holiness. We pray that you might help us to respond with our lives. And we are mindful that your blessed mother is our mother, and that she intercedes and helps us. And so let us pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother God, pray for us sinners now at the hour of our death. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And let us go in peace.